Chapter 16, Digestion and Absorption. Food is one of the basic requirements for all living organisms. The major components of our food are carbohydrates, proteins and fats. Vitamins and minerals are also required in small quantities. Food provides energy and organic materials for growth and repair of tissues. The water we take in plays an important role in metabolic processes and also prevents dehydration of the body. Biomacromolecules in food cannot be utilized by our body in their original form. They have to be broken down and converted into simple substances in the digestive system. This process of conversion of complex food substances to simple absorbable forms is called digestion and is carried out by our digestive system by mechanical and biochemical methods. General organization of human digestive system is shown in figure 16.1. 16.1 Digestive System. The human digestive system consists of the alimentary canal and the associated glands. 16.1.1 Alimentary Canal. The alimentary canal begins with an anterior opening, the mouth, and it opens out posteriorly through the anus. The mouth leads to the buccal cavity or oral cavity. The oral cavity has a number of teeth and a muscular tongue. Each tooth is embedded in a socket of jawbone. This type of attachment is called thecodont. Majority of mammals, including human beings, forms two sets of teeth during their life. A set of temporary milk or deciduous teeth replaced by a set of permanent or adult teeth. This type of definition is called diphyodont. An adult human has 32 permanent teeth, which are of four types. Heterodont dentition, that is, namely incisors, canine, premolars and molars. Arrangement of teeth in each half of the upper and lower jaw in the order ICPMM is represented by the dental formula, which in human is 2123 upon 2123. The hard chewing surface of the teeth made up of enamel helps in the mastication of food. The tongue is a freely movable vascular organ attached to the floor of the oral cavity by the frenulum. The upper surface of the tongue has a small projections called papillae, some of which bear taste buds. The oral cavity leads into a short pharynx, which serves as a common passage for food and air. The esophagus and the trachea, that is windpipe, open into the pharynx. A cartilaginous flap called epiglottis prevents the entry of food into glottis. Opening of the windpipe during swallowing. The esophagus is a thin, long tube which extends posteriorly, passing through the neck, thorax and diaphragm, and leads to a J-shaped bag-like structure called a stomach. A muscular sphincter, that is gastroesophageal, regulates the opening of esophagus into the stomach. The stomach, located in the upper left portion of the abdominal cavity, has four major parts: a cardiac portion into which the esophagus opens, a fundic region, body, and a pyloric portion which opens into the first part of a small intestine. The small intestine is distinguishable into three regions: a C-shaped duodenum, a long coiled middle portion jejunum, and a highly coiled ileum. The opening of the stomach into the duodenum is guarded by the pyloric sphincter. Ileum opens into the large intestine. It consists of cecum, colon, and rectum. Cecum is a small blind sac which hosts some symbiotic microorganisms, a narrow finger-like tubular projection. The vermiform appendix, which is a vestigial organ, arises from the cecum. The cecum opens into the colon. The colon is divided into four parts: an ascending, a transverse, descending part, and a sigmoid colon. The descending part opens into the rectum, which opens out through the anus. The wall of alimentary canal from esophagus to rectum possesses four layers, namely serosa, muscularis, submucosa and mucosa. Serosa is the outermost layer and is made up of a thin mesothelium with some connective tissues. Muscularis is formed by smooth muscles, usually arranged into an inner circular and an outer longitudinal layer. An oblique muscle layer may be present in some regions. The submucosal layer is formed of loose connective tissues containing nerves, blood and lymph vessels. In duodenum, glands are also present in submucosa. The innermost layer lining the lumen of the alimentary canal is the mucosa. This layer forms irregular folds in the stomach and small finger-like foldings called villi in the small intestine. The cells lining the villi produce numerous microscopic projections called microvilli. giving a brush border appearance. These modifications increase the surface area enormously. Villi are supplied with a network of capillaries and a large lymph vessel called the lacteal. Mucosal epithelium has goblet cells which secrete mucus that help in lubrication. Mucosa also forms glands in the stomach, that is gastric glands, and crypts in between the bases of villi in the intestine, that is known as crypts of Leverkin. All the four layers show modifications in different parts of the alimentary canal. 16.1.2 Digestive glands. The digestive glands associated with the alimentary canal include the salivary glands, the liver and the pancreas. Saliva is mainly produced by three pairs of salivary glands, the parotids, that is cheek, the submaxillary, submandibular lower jaw and the sublinguals, that is below the tongue. These glands situated just outside the buccal cavity secrete salivary juice into the buccal cavity. Liver is the largest gland of the body, weighing about 1.2 to 1.5 kg in an adult human. It is situated in the abdominal cavity just below the diaphragm and has two lobes. The hepatic lobules are the structural and functional units of liver containing hepatic cells arranged in the form of cords. Each lobule is covered by a thin connective tissue sheath called the Glisson's capsule. The bile secreted by the hepatic cells passes through a hepatic duct and is stored and concentrated in a thin muscular sac called the gallbladder. The duct of gallbladder, that is cystic duct, along with the hepatic duct from the liver forms the common bile duct. The bile duct and the pancreatic duct open together into the duodenum as the common hepatopancreatic duct, which is guarded by a sphincter called the sphincter of Oddi. The pancreas is a compound, both exocrine and endocrine, elongated organ situated between the limbs of C-shaped duodenum. The exocrine portion secretes an alkaline pancreatic juice containing enzymes, and the endocrine portion secretes hormones, insulin and glucagon. 16.2 Digestion of food. The process of digestion is accomplished by mechanical and chemical processes. The buccal cavity performs two major functions, mastication of food and facilitation of swallowing. The teeth and the tongue with the help of saliva masticate and mix up the food thoroughly. Mucus in saliva helps in lubricating and adhering the masticated food particles into bolus. The bolus is then conveyed into the pharynx and then into the esophagus by swallowing or deglutition. The bolus further passes down through the esophagus by successive waves of muscular contraction called peristalsis. The gastroesophageal sphincter controls the passage of food into the stomach. The saliva secreted into the oral cavity contains electrolytes, sodium, potassium, chloride and HCO3 ion and enzymes, salivary amylase and lysozyme. The chemical process of digestion is initiated in the oral cavity by the hydrolytic action of the carbohydrate splitting enzyme, the salivary amylase. About 30% of starch is hydrolyzed here by this enzyme, optimum pH is 6.8, into a disaccharide, that is maltose. Lysozyme present in the saliva acts as an antibacterial agent that prevents infection. The starch is converting into the maltose in the presence of salivary amylase at pH 6.8. The mucosa of the stomach has gastric glands. Gastric glands have three major types of cells, namely number 1, mucus neck cells which secrete mucus, number 2, peptic or chief cells which secrete the proenzyme pepsinogens, and number 3, parietal or oxyntic cells which secrete HCl and intrinsic factor, that is factor essential for absorption of vitamin B12. The stomach stores the food for 4 to 5 hours. The food mixes thoroughly with the acidic gastric juice of the stomach by the churning movements of its muscular wall and is called the chyme. The proenzyme pepsinogen on exposure to hydrochloric acid gets converted into the active enzyme pepsin, the proteolytic enzyme of the stomach. Pepsin converts protein into proteoses and peptones, that is peptides. The mucus and bicarbonates present in the gastric juice play an important role in lubrication and protection of the mucosal epithelium from exsoriation by the highly concentrated hydrochloric acid. HCl provides the acidic pH, that is pH 1.8, optimal for pepsins. Renin is a proteolytic enzyme found in gastric juice of infants, which helps in the digestion of the milk proteins. Small amounts of lipases are also secreted by gastric glands. Various types of movements are generated by the muscularis layer of the small intestine. These movements help in a thorough mixing of the food with various secretions in the intestine and thereby facilitate digestion. The bile pancreatic juice and the intestinal juice are the secretions released into the small intestine. Pancreatic juice and bile are released through the hepatopancreatic duct. The pancreatic juice contains inactive enzymes, trypsinogen, chymotrypsinogen, procarboxypeptidases, amylases, lipases, and nucleases. Trypsinogen is activated by an enzyme, enterokinase, secreted by the intestinal mucosa into active trypsin, which in turn activates the other enzymes in the pancreatic juice. The bile released into the duodenum contains bile pigments, bilirubin and biliverdin, bile salts, cholesterol and phospholipids, but no enzymes. Bile helps in emulsification of fats, that is, breaking down of the fats into very small micelles. Bile also activates lipases. The intestinal mucosal epithelium has goblet cells, which secrete mucus. The secretions of the brush border cells of the mucosa along with the secretions of the goblet cells constitute the intestinal juice or succus entericus. The juice contains a variety of enzymes like disaccharidase, example maltase, dipeptidases, lipases, nucleosidases, etc. The mucus along with the bicarbonates from the pancreas protects the intestinal mucosa from acid as well as provide an alkaline medium. pH is 7.8 for enzymatic activities. Some mucosal glands, that is Brunner's glands, also helps in this. Proteins, proteases and peptones, partially hydrolyzed proteins in the chyme reaching the intestines are acted upon by the proteolytic enzymes of pancreatic juice as given below. Proteins, peptones, proteases converts into the dipeptides in the presence of trypsin or chymotrypsin and carboxypeptidase. Carbohydrates in the chymes are hydrolyzed by pancreatic amylase into disaccharides. Polysaccharides, that is a starch, is converted into the disaccharides in the presence of amylase. Fats are broken down by lipases with the help of bile into di- and monoglycerides. Fats is converted into diglycerides with the presence of lipases and then after converted into the monoglycerides. Nucleases in the pancreatic juice acts on nucleic acids to form nucleotides and nucleosides. Nucleic acids in the presence of nucleases converts into the nucleotides and after that they convert into the nucleosides. The enzyme in the succus entericus act on the end product of the above reactions to form the respective simple absorbable form. These final steps in digestion occurs very close to the mucosal epithelial cells of the intestine. Dipeptides in the presence of dipeptidase converts into the amino acids. Maltose in the presence of maltase converts into the glucose plus glucose. Lactose in the presence of lactase converts into the glucose and galactose. Sucrose in the presence of sucrase converted into the glucose and fructose. Nucleotides in the presence of nucleotidase converts into the nucleosides. And then in the presence of nucleosidases, it converts into the sugars and bases. Di- and monoglycerides in the presence of lipases converts into the fatty acids and glycerol. The breakdown of biomacromolecules mentioned above occurs in the duodenum, region of the small intestine. The simple substances thus formed are absorbed in the jejunum and ileum regions of the small intestine. The undigested and unabsorbed substances are passed on to the large intestine. No significant digestive activity occurs in the large intestine. The functions of large intestines are number 1. Absorption of some water minerals and certain drugs. Number 2. Secretion of mucus, which helps in adhering the waste, undigested particles together and lubricating it for an easy passage. The undigested and absorbed substances called fecus enters into the cecum of the large intestine through ileocecal valve, which prevents the backflow of the fecal matter. It is temporarily stored in the rectum till defecation. The activities of the gastrointestinal tract are under neural and hormonal control for proper coordination of different parts. The sight, smell and or the presence of food in the oral cavity can stimulate the secretion of saliva. Gastric and intestinal secretions are also similarly stimulated by neural signals. The muscular activities of different parts of the alimentary canal can also be moderated by neural mechanism, both local and through CNS. Hormonal control of the secretion of the digestive juices is carried out by local hormones produced by the gastric and intestinal mucosa. Caloric value of protein, carbohydrate and fat. The energy requirements of animals and the energy content of food are expressed in terms of measures of heat energy, because heat is the ultimate form of all energies. This is often measured to as calories or joule, which is the amount of heat energy required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of water by 1 degree Celsius. Since this value is tiny amount of energy, physiologists commonly use kilocalorie or kilojoule. 1 kilocalorie is the amount of energy required to raise the temperature of 1 kilogram of water by 1 degree Celsius. Nutritionists traditionally refer to kilocalorie as the calorie or joule, always capitalized. The amount of heat liberated from the complete combustion of 1 gram food in a bomb calorimeter is its gross calorific or gross energy value. The actual amount of the energy combustion of 1 gram of food is the physiologic value of food. Gross calorific values of carbohydrates, proteins and fats are 4.1 kilocalorie per gram, 5.65 kilocalorie per gram and 9.45 kilocalorie per gram respectively, whereas their physiologic values are 4 kilocalorie per gram, 4 kilocalorie per gram and 9 kilocalorie per gram respectively. 16.3 Absorption of digested products. Absorption is a process by which the end products of digestion pass through the intestinal mucosa into the blood or lymph. It is carried out by passive, active or facilitated transport mechanisms. The small amounts of monosaccharides like glucose, amino acids and some electrolytes like chloride ions are generally absorbed by simple diffusion. The passage of these substances into the blood depends upon the concentration gradients. However, some substances like glucose and amino acids are absorbed with the help of carrier proteins. This mechanism is called the facilitated transport. Transport of water depends upon the osmotic gradient. Active transport occurs against the concentration gradient and hence requires energy. Various nutrients like amino acids, monosaccharides like glucose, electrolytes like sodium ion are absorbed into the blood by this mechanism. Fatty acids and glycerols, being insoluble, cannot be absorbed into the blood. They are first incorporated into small droplets called micelles, which move into the intestinal mucosa. They are deformed into very small protein-coated fat globules called chylomicrons, which are transported into the lymph vessels, that is lacteals, in the villi. These lymph vessels ultimately release the absorbed substances into the bloodstream. Absorption of substances takes place in different parts of the alimentary canal, like mouth, stomach, small intestine and large intestine. However, maximum absorption occurs in the small intestine. A summary of absorption, that is sites of absorption and substances absorbed, is given in table 16.1. Mouth. Certain drugs coming in contact with the mucosa of mouth and lower side of the tongue are absorbed into the blood capillaries lining in them. Stomach. Absorption of water, simple sugars and alcohol, etc. takes place. The small intestine, principal organ for absorption of nutrients, the digestion is completed here and the final product of digestion such as glucose, fructose, fatty acids, glycerols and amino acids are absorbed through the mucosa into the bloodstream and lymph. Large intestine, absorption of water, some minerals and drugs takes place. The absorbed substances finally reach the tissues which utilize them for their activities. This process is called assimilation. The digestive waste solidified into coherent feces in the rectum initiate a neural reflex causing an urge or desire for its removal. The ejection of feces to the outside through the anal opening, that is defecation, is a voluntary process and is carried out by a mass peristaltic movement. 16.4 Disorders of Digestive System. The inflammation of the intestinal tract is the most common ailment due to the bacterial or viral infections. The infections are also caused by the parasites of the intestine like tapeworm, roundworm, threadworm, hookworm, pinworm, etc. Jaundice, the liver is affected, skin and eyes turn yellow due to the deposit of bile pigments. Vomiting, it is the ejection of stomach contents through the mouth. This reflex action is controlled by the vomit center in the medulla. A feeling of nausea precedes vomiting. Diarrhea, the abnormal frequency of bowel movement and increased liquidity of the fecal discharge is known as diarrhea. It reduces the absorption of food. Constipation. In constipation, the feces are retained within the colon as the bowel movements occurs irregularly. Indigestion. In this condition, the food is not properly digested, leading to a feeling of fullness. The causes of indigestion are inadequate enzyme secretion and anxiety, food poisoning, overeating and spicy food. PEM. Dietary deficiency of protein and total food calories are widespread in many underdeveloped countries of South and Southeast Asia, South America and West and Central Africa. Protein energy malnutrition, PEM, may affect large sections of the population during drought, famine and political turmoil. This happened in Bangladesh during the Liberation War and in Ethiopia during the severe drought in mid-80s. PEM affects infants and children to produce marasmus and kwashiorkor. Marasmus is produced by a simultaneous deficiency of proteins and calories. It is found in infants less than a year in age. If mother's milk is replaced too early by other foods which are poor in both proteins and caloric value, this often happens if the mother has second pregnancy or childbirth when the older infant is still too young. In marasmus, protein deficiency impairs growth and replacement of tissue proteins, extreme emaciation of the body and thinning of the limbs results. The skin becomes dry, thin and wrinkled. Growth rate and body weight decline considerably. Even growth and development of brain and mental faculties are impaired. Kwashiorkor is produced by protein deficiency unaccompanied by calorie deficiency. It results from the replacement of mother's milk by a high-calorie, low-protein diet in a child more than 1 year in age. Like marasmus, kwashiorkor shows wasting of muscles, thinning of limbs, failure of growth and brain development. But unlike marasmus, some fat is still left under the skin. Moreover, extensive oedema and swelling of body parts are seen. Summary. The digestive system of humans consists of an alimentary canal and associated digestive glands. The alimentary canal consists of the mouth, buccal cavity, pharynx, oesophagus, stomach, small intestine, large intestine, rectum and the anus. The accessory digestive glands include the salivary glands, the liver with gallbladder and the pancreas. Inside the mouth of teeth masticates the food. The tongue tastes the food and manipulates it for proper mastication by mixing it with the saliva. Saliva contains a starch digestive enzyme, salivary amylase, that digests the starch and converts it into maltose disaccharide. The food then passes into the pharynx and enters the oesophagus in the form of bolus, which is further carried down through the esophagus by peristalsis into the stomach. In a stomach, mainly protein digestion takes place. Absorption of simple sugars, alcohols, and medicines also takes place in the stomach. The chyme or food enters into the duodenum portion of the small intestine and is acted on by the pancreatic juice, bile and finally by the enzymes in the succus entericus, so that the digestion of carbohydrates, proteins and fats is completed. The food then enters into the jejunum and ileum portions of the small intestine. The carbohydrates are digested and converted into monosaccharides like glucose. Proteins are finally broken down into amino acids. The fats are converted to fatty acids and glycerol. The digested end products are absorbed into the body through the epithelial lining of the intestinal villi. The undigested food fecus enters into the cecum of the large intestine through ileocecal valve, which prevents the backflow of the fecal matter. Most of the water is absorbed in the large intestine. The undigested food becomes semi-solid in nature and then enters into the rectum, anal canal and is finally adjusted out through the anus. Chapter completed. Thank you so much.